Okay, so welcome everyone to this lovely webinar that we are planned today on the occasion of World Heart Day. And I'm extremely happy that I've got very, very eminent speakers and panelists today for my webinar. So let me first have a brief introduction of the panelists to the participants. The first panelist today that we have is Dr. Vijay Pathak. Dr. Vijay Pathak has done his MBBS from SMS Jaipur. He has done his MD again from SMS Jaipur, DNB Cardio from National Board of Examinations, DM Cardio from PGI Chandigarh. Dr. Pathak is a practicing cardiologist for more than 25 years. He is one of the most prominent names in the field of cardiology, and patients worship him like God. His dedication towards his profession and his experience has made him one of the most sought after doctors beyond the boundaries of the city of Jaipur. He is a medical professional who is extremely spiritually inclined and believes that service to humanity is service to God. I welcome you, Doctor. I'm very happy to have you here today.
Thank you. Thank you for the nice introduction.
And the second panelist today is Ms. Poonam Vaswani. Ms. Poonam Vaswani is a clinical dietitian and certified diabetes educator. She got her master's degree in foods and nutrition and PG diploma in dietetics and applied nutrition from Mumbai University. She has been a meritorious student throughout her academic tenure. Ms. Vaswani has been working extensively in the field of clinical diet counseling and nutrition education for over 20 years. She has counseled patients with a variety of clinical conditions like diabetes, heart, cancer, metabolic syndrome, etc., and has been also imparting education to students of hospitality, gym trainers, coaches, and cancer caregivers. She is a member of Indian Dietetic Association, International Association for Eternal and Prenatal Nutrition and Nutrition Society of India. Her knowledge and counseling skills have gained enormous confidence and makes her very popular among her patients and is therefore a renowned name in the field of nutrition. I welcome you, Dr. Vaswani, to the webinar. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much.
So I think now I should just straight away start with the webinar. I am told and I know that Doc Sab is also not keeping well these days, so I don't want to take too much time off his, but he has so graciously agreed to still be a part of this webinar that was planned many days ago.
It's a pleasure. It's a pleasure.
Thank you. Thank you for agreeing and being a part. So the session is yours, sir. You can start with your talk if you...
No, I thought it's going to be a
discussion kind of a thing.
Yes.
Actually, Doc Sir, you just need to give a little bit of awareness to the patients about what are the various diseases related to heart and how can they be aware about heart health? Like, when should they bother and worry about not being well? So what things they should take into consideration, at what age they should go for which kind of test? That's it.
Okay. I would say my first submission would be prevention is better than cure, than treatment, because if you don't have disease, then you really don't have to suffer at all. Once you have disease, then there's always a point whether or not you are going to respond to medication, how much, and you have already suffered the onslaught of the disease. So it's always better to prevent it. So preventive aspect of cardiology is so important, but so less stressed upon.
Yes.
Okay. So keeping a healthy lifestyle, as all webinars and all seminars, everything would, everywhere they would say. So you have to maintain a healthy lifestyle. How's that? Is taking care of the diet. It should be proper diet. Then your exercise schedule should be fixed and absolutely in order. Stress reduction is one of the major factors which can prevent heart disease. And so many other diseases like diabetes and hypertension along, which, you know, compel more heart diseases. So taking care of associated diseases is also one of the part of treatment and prevention of heart disease.
So doctor, which are the major cardiovascular diseases that people in age group of say above 30 should worry about?
And above 30. Well, there are... See, if you look at the heart, then there are different components, different parts of the heart. Heart is an organ which is about the size of the fist, but it has endless endless sources of problems. And if you go from without to within, it is the first the superficial layer, which is the membrane which covers the heart, which is called pericardium. Then you have epicardium and the muscle, which is myocardium. Then there are valves, which is called the part of endocardium. And then there is blood in the chambers of the heart, which if gone faulty, then they can give a lot of problem to the people. So above 30, if we see, the major detractors are hypertension. And hypertension comes in the realms of cardiology because it is a risk factor for arterial blockages, as well as blindness, cerebrovascular accidents and paralysis, kidney failures. So hypertension can be a very nasty thing. Hypertension above the age of 14, 90% people don't know what the reason is. Less than 14, there are a few reasons which can be there, but then that we are talking about age 30 plus. So it is primary hypertension mostly. That means we don't know the reason, but in case the hypertension is there, then you have to treat it, as simple as that, right? So
Doctor, hypertension generally, which is the age where you should start worrying about your heart health? Actually, this is what I mean to say. Which is that age of range where you should take more care?
I would say if we have a good lifestyle, then we don't have to worry about the heart. But yes, of course, 40 plus, 40 okay. and above, you okay. have to be. In fact, the American Heart Association advises doing cholesterol levels at the age of 20 years and thereafter every 5 years. And then you go to maybe 40 and then it should be done every 3 years, 2 years. So that's about the cholesterol. So you have to start getting worried. 40 plus is the range. But say cholesterol later on compels arterial blockage. So you have to have the sampling of your cholesterol done every 5 years after 20 years of age, right? That's it.
All right.
Then you can have coronary artery disease after 40. In India, almost 20% people are less than 40 years age because India is a very heavily populated country. Per square kilometer population, if you Google, you'll find out that there are few countries which can compete with us. China is almost our population, maybe slightly more, but the area is 3 to 4 times more. So per kilometer population is less in China. And that's why the population density, it's such a dense population that people are likely to get diseases. Then lifestyle is not good. Lot of tobacco and alcohol consumption is there. Stress is there in life. So in India, 40 plus, the people of coronary artery disease means blockage leading to heart attack. They're almost to the tune of 20% among all heart diseases, all the coronary artery diseases, obstructive ischemic heart disease, 20% of them are going to be less than 40 years. In fact, we have a study published to that effect that our cholesterol is abnormal. And there are many other factors in Indian population which get you heart disease below the age of 40. Unlike the Western countries, which are modernized, but yet we exceed them. Plus, the number of people are there. So, the number, total absolute number of heart patients goes up. So, we presume that we are soon going to be the ischemic epidemic of the world.
That is why, Dr. Sahab, I believe this day is being celebrated and there is a whole process to create an awareness and there is a lot of awareness being created all around. Because yes. I believe when I was going through the mortality causes also, so heart disease is one of the biggest, CVDs is one of the biggest reasons for mortality also in India.
Yes, after cancer, yes.
After cancer, yes.
Yes, it's a very huge number. And then there are diseases which are because of the valve, like aortic stenosis, but that generally comes after 60, 70 years of age, blood pressure. Cerebrovascular accidents, which lead to paralysis, like brain hemorrhage, like clotting in the brain, kidney failures. They are all because of the common factors which lead to heart disease. And they also lead to cerebrovascular accidents as well.
Okay. So, Dr. Sahab, which are the basic tests one should go for and at what age? Like, just to be careful and just to be aware that I am okay.
See, as
because
I said,
you sometimes don't know unless you get an attack or unless you have some problem and you are rushed to the hospital. So
yes, so we call this primordial prevention. So before the disease is there, before the risk factors are there, you try to seek them out. Yes. One of them is cholesterol at the age of 20 years. Of course, a sample of blood sugar won't harm. Then the tests related to the kidney, the electrolytes, because sometimes the BP comes because there are certain conditions of the electrolytes which are abnormal. That's why the BP goes up. Okay. And then all the basic tests like uric acid, which is frequently associated with the cardiovascular mortality. Vitamin D3 levels are very, very important, which are generally by and large low in Indian population. And they lead to various types of disorders. One of them is predisposition to corona. The low vitamin D3 is the only factor which has been found to have a correlation with corona morbidity and mortality both.
Really?
Yeah. So vitamin D3 is only set because those people who have died of corona or who have had severe corona disease, so corona infection, you will find that 77% are deficient in vitamin D3.
Oh,
it is such an important risk factor even for corona.
This is big information.
Yes. And that is the only risk factor for corona which has been identified really, excepting that you contact closely with people who have corona, active corona. That is, of course, the biggest because corona has a very high strike rate. It's like Donald Bradman, who had a strike rate of 99.98%. So that too, because he got out in his last innings, he got out on a duck. Otherwise, it would have been 100%. So here, the corona is equally, I mean, it's really a miracle if you come in contact with a corona patient closely and you don't contract. In case your D3 is low, then you are 100% going to get it.
Oh,
so that's it.
Okay.
So other tests that we, I'm sorry, I deviated from the topic. So other tests which after 40 would be advisable would be ECG. And then there is something called executive health checkup. So among all these, cholesterol, sugar, urea, creatinine, electrolytes, uric acid, and apolipoproteins, various fractions of cholesterol, you need to get an ECG, chest x-rays to avoid it unless you have symptoms, and a treadmill won't harm. But in case you have risk factors, it is a good idea to do treadmill as well as echo. If there are symptoms like dizziness, then a Holter should be in order. So these are the basically the tests which should be done. Say it's very difficult to say how frequently, maybe once in 3 years, 4 years. But in case you have disease or you have a risk factors for disease, then you have to get it done more frequently according to your physician's advice or your doctor's advice. That's it. I can't hear you.
Yeah, sorry. I was on mute. I am asking you, Doctor, that sometimes these days a lot of kids also have got a lot of heart problems. So are they also related to nutrition or that is genetic?
Who?
Small kids, teenagers.
Yes.
And
yes. So it depends on what type of heart disease we are talking to. See, talking about teenagers, youngsters, especially those who are athletes. We find and we hear that there are many sudden deaths while exercising or just after completing exercise in young teenagers who have just started high level, you know, athletic training or athletic endeavors or competitive. So these patients, the most frequent cause is something like, which is called hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. That means abnormal, unexplained thickening of the walls of the heart, which lead to very fast heart rates during exercise. And the people die. Another cause is abnormal QT prolongation, where there is an abnormality specific on the ECG, which can point out that if you exercise too heavily, you may have a sudden death. Then there are many kind of disorders in teenagers. But yes, occasionally you may find people who are youngsters, in fact, very young, 1-2 years old, and they get heart disease. They get heart disease means obstruction of the arteries of the heart. and they are familial dyslipidemias or hyperlipoproteinemias.
They must be genetic, doctor.
They are generally genetically predisposed, and it depends which type of gene configuration they have. If both the genes of the same disease come from mother as well as father, then the child is sure to get the disease at a very early age. The high cholesterol. So the total cholesterol to the tune of 300 plus, 400 plus, that kind. In a normal person, it is expected to be less than 200.
Yes.
So you may find such people in clusters in families. So we call them familial dyslipidemias.
Okay. The whole family must be suffering from the same disease.
Yes, many children in the same family, like homozygous twins might get it the same way, or you may get familial dyslipidemias. That's because of genetic makeup. And then there are apolipoproteins, mutations into which also may lead to early coronary artery disease.
Okay.
These hypertrophic cardiomyopathies and, say, what I was saying about ECG abnormality, QT interval abnormalities, they are also genetically determined. And there is some problem with the gene of one component of the heart muscle or one component of the electrical conduction system, which may lead to sudden deaths.
But beyond that, like, if we don't talk about the genetic reasons, beyond that, yes, it is mostly related to diet and lifestyle, right?
Yes, it is, especially in the youngsters also, because now, because of the advent of the social media and the mobiles and the internet and televisions, the children are less given to physical effort. And that takes away the part of them to remain healthy. They eat while sitting there. Watch what we typically call couch potatoes. So they develop into couch potatoes and they eat well. They eat fast food and lot of oil. Then they also get into those vices of consuming tobacco, alcohol, hookah. And, you know, the culture changes. We have gone to the vices of Western culture. Yes. Our own culture we have forgotten.
Yes.
I
know, Dr. Saab, you are very, very much hurt with the fact that India is really being westernized and India is not keeping to its roots. I know that you are a very strong believer and opposer of this fact. In fact, I remember you asking me that awareness to Hindi mein create karni chahiye. So are we talking in English or Hindi? I remember you asking me that. So yes, I know you wanted to have it in Hindi because aapko ye hai ki bhai Hindi mein log zyada sun paate hain, zyada samajh paate hain.
It's actually the family's responsibility. It's the responsibility of the parents. Parents, hamare structure mein, we used to have joint families and there were fewer diseases and fewer people to tend to. And there was a group effort. If I had grandparents, then well, I had cousins who would also club in and take care of grandparents. They were well taken care of. Nuclear families and now ultra-nuclear families. So ultimately, we have forgotten our culture and we have a price to pay.
Yes, doctor. So I believe there'll be a lot of questions also later after the session, doctor.
Yes.
So I think if you have anything else, if you want to talk about anything else, more about etiology or maybe spread or whatever, bata dije, nahi to then.
No, I actually... Actually, I think we have a very good person available here, Dr. Yes. Poonam, who can talk a lot about diet. And I think I have a lot to learn from her as well.
Yes.
So it would be good if we could listen to her. No?
That is the whole idea, to bring her in, Dr. Saab, so that we can have the aspects about nutrition, which is one of the key factors and key role players in this disease. So
yes.
Now I would call upon Ms. Poonam to...
Thank you so much, Dr. Pathak. That was really very hello. So that was very enlightening. There were so many points there, which I think, you know, will be highlighted again in my talk. Since, you know, the medical part and the nutrition part are so interrelated that we can't really separate and understand understanding of the two from each other.
Yes.
So I will share my presentation while I talk.
Yes, ma'am.
So, sure. Yeah. So we are here today to celebrate the World Heart Day. And, you know, I'm very passionate about nutrition. And, you know, so whatever I'm going to talk today is going to come from my heart. And so let's see what the current scenario is. Now, this is data which I have picked up from WHO. And if we look at the current incidence, you know, cardiovascular disease is now claiming, you know, world over, it's claiming 17.7 million lives per year. And one third of these are people under the age of 70 years. And the number is rising continuously. So all these deaths.
Hello?
Yeah.
Sorry, hello? Ma'am, your screen is not visible actually.
Not visible?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Sorry. I'll just share one second. Can you see it now?
Yeah, it is starting. Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Okay. Great. So I was on the first slide. Basically what I was saying is that, 17.7 million people, you know, suffer from cardiovascular disease world over. And most of these, about one third of these are people below the age of 70. And the number is rising very steadily all over the world. So what are these people really dying of? They're basically dying of heart attacks and strokes. And if you see, you know, that if you look at more data, you'll realize that 75% of these heart attacks and strokes are occurring in the developing countries. So we know that we are one of these countries and how prevalent heart disease is over here for us. So what are the changes? What are the challenges that developing nations are facing? Basically, we all understand that there's economic transition, there's urbanization, industrialization, globalization. All these things are leading to major lifestyle changes. And these lifestyle changes, we are going to be talking about those. And these, all the changes that have happened are the ones that promote heart disease. So this is a problem that we are facing all the time nowadays. In fact, we've seen that, you know, the incidence of heart disease is moving. It's already there in the urban areas, but now we are seeing more of it affecting the rural areas also. I'm sure Dr. Pathak also must be getting a lot of patients from the rural areas who are now suffering from heart disease.
Yes, we never saw.
Yeah. Yes,
sorry.
No, please go ahead.
No. I said, we keep getting them.
Yes. Okay. So what are the risk factors? We've already talked about it. Dr. Pathak's talked about it. But if I just put it, you know, in a concise manner. So what are modifiable? We have modifiable and non-modifiable. So non-modifiable would be things which are beyond our control. We are born with, we just spoke of the genetic part of it and the ethnic backgrounds. There are some ethnic backgrounds, you know, people from certain communities, parts of the world where they are genetically more prone to heart disease. So that's another non-modifiable factor. Age, as age progresses, and if, you know, it's combined with other lifestyle risks, then the risk also increases. So if you talk of the modifiable risks, what are those? Obesity, tobacco use, hypertension, diabetes mellitus, hypercholesterolemia, that's dyslipidemia, physical inactivity and sedentary behavior. Now this next one, depression and social isolation. These were probably things that were not discussed too much earlier. But now more and more we are seeing that stress, depression and social isolation are contributing in a big way to heart disease. So these are things we have to talk about and address more than we ever used to address earlier before. So what is stress do? Stress can encourage some other behavior, like, you know, it can encourage smoking, alcohol consumption, even overeating, which ultimately leads to obesity or overweight. So all these things put together, and, you know, it is seen that when you look at these modifiable risk factors, you'll see that in the same person, you'll have obesity, you'll have hypertension, you'll have type 2 diabetes, you'll have dyslipidemia. all these things occur in the same person, you know. So we call that situation a metabolic syndrome case. So these are becoming extremely common in India these days. I myself see a lot of cases of metabolic syndrome, you know, where you have more than one or two conditions, three conditions minimum coming to you at the same time. And most of the time it's, you know, the beginning is obesity. So let's see, there was a prediction, you know, for India that what are we going to see by 2040? This is a very new report, which was published in February 2020, this year itself. So what do we see that, you know, overweight is going to double in the age group of 20 to 69 by 2040. And if you talk of obesity, so overweight is one level and beyond that is obesity. The incidence of obesity is going to triple, which is like really scary. And we are going to see that this change is going to be more in the older age groups. These are predictive, you know, based on a lot of statistical analysis. And see this, that the relative increase in rural areas is going to be larger as compared to urban areas. And this is what I was just emphasizing. Now, what is obesity really do? So when we are talking of obesity, you know, we have something called central obesity and we have peripheral obesity. So central would be something, you know, around your abdominal region, you have a lot of fat. So you see, you know, typical, we see people with very large bellies. And I have clients coming to me all the time and telling me, mera pet kam kara do. Now, you can't just do pet kam karana, is not that easy, you know. It has to, you have to work on the entire fat in the body, and the stomach is, you know, the abdominal fat or the visceral fat is very deep set. That's probably the last thing that's going to go. We can't have spot reduction of only the abdominal area. So that is called the central obesity, and that is like very risky in terms of the, you know, the impact that it has on you know, creating heart problems or diabetes or, you know, even high cholesterol, blood pressure. These are all, you know, central obesity has a huge impact on that. Then you have peripheral obesity, which will be more of, you know, the thigh area, the buttock area. So the little lower than the abdominal area. So that is peripheral. So there is a whole, you know, impact of what this these fat portions do to the body. And so I've shown you the entire impact that it has. And finally, it reaches, you know, it leads to vascular injury. That's the vessels, and it causes myocardial injury. So now, what do you do? The first thing is, you know, that obesity has to be addressed. That's the first thing. When somebody comes to me, we first look at what is the BMI, what is the fat level, and start working on weight first. So how do you reduce weight? Obviously, we have to look at the diet and what is wrong with the diet, modify the diet, correct the diet, maybe, you know, do some calorie restriction if required. Then along with that, physical activity, we know that, you know, physical activity burns calories. So when we are counting calories, diet and physical activity will both contribute in the process. Then we have managing stress and managing sleep hours. So stress is something which has a huge impact on weight. So when we have people, you know, when I have people coming to me for reducing weight, I first also talk to them about their stress levels and how we are going to address the stress levels for that person. There are different ways in which you can address stress. It could be just doing something you enjoy, involving yourself in a hobby. It could involve, you know, some for somebody, just going for a jog could be something that can manage stress for the person. For somebody else, it may be yoga, it may be pranayama, deep breathing. There are so many different ways. For each person, what reduces the stress is different. Then sleep, very important to get adequate sleep and follow the circadian rhythm. You know, we are more and more talking about following the rhythm of the body, the biological clock of the body. another reason why we see that young people are struggling so much with lifestyle disorders today is because of their sleep patterns. They, you know, they may be getting 8 hours, 10 hours of sleep, but when are they getting that sleep? If they start that sleep at 3 a.m. and then they complete it at 8 hours, you know, into half the day the next day, that is not the way to, that's not really working for them. The number of hours is okay, but not the type, the pattern or the timing when you should sleep. The body has a clock. If we are in rhythm with the body, there will be half these problems will be taken care of. So we address sleep related issues, all the hormonal related problems. You know, the first thing that we talk about is sleep patterns. I have a lot of, you know, clients coming to me with hypothyroidism, with PCOS, young girls coming to me with a lot of PCOS problems. So we first address lifestyle, and sleep is the first thing that I talk about. So if we talk of reducing weight, about 5 to 10% of weight loss also, you will see that there is a significant reduction in the risk factors at 1 year. And as the weight loss increases over the years, we'll see the risk goes on reducing. Even if somebody has non-modifiable risk factors, meaning, you know, you have a lot of very strong genetic tendency, because like doctor just said that both parents, if they have this, the genes, you know, the likelihood of the child getting it is much higher. But if at the same time, the child is managing their lifestyle well, taking care of, you know, diet, activities, stress, sleep, then the chances can be reduced by a great extent. Okay, now we come to high blood pressure, which is one of the first, you know, one of the most important risk factors. And we've seen that again in the low and middle income countries, the risk of dying from high BP is double than it is in the high income countries. Again, the causes could be obesity and diet. Now, when we talk of diet, I would like to focus on the one thing that, you know, we have to look at, that is the salt intake in our diet. And when we talk of salt, it's not, we're not really worried about, so we know that salt is sodium and chloride combined, sodium chloride. So it's the sodium fraction in the salt, which is a determinant of the blood pressure and what impact it can have on it. So as you know, WHO has, there are member states of WHO, and we've set a target that by 2025, we will try and reduce the intake of salt for everybody to 5 grams a day. So when we talk of 5 grams a day, that 5 grams of salt has only 2 grams of sodium. So if we limit the intake to 5 grams, we are ensuring that that 2 grams is going to be okay for most of us. And reducing salt, I mean, why are we focusing so much on it? Because it's the easiest and the most cost-effective intervention to save lives, to prevent diseases, and to reduce healthcare costs. I mean, it's such a simple thing to do, you know, to reduce the intake of salt. And still people don't give it much attention. I have seen people, you know, sprinkling salt freely on their food, in the atta that they make, there is salt going into that. So if you really start considering the amount of salt you eat, it's way beyond the body's requirement of 5 grams. So I want to show you this. I'm just, you know, making it going back to the smaller slide, because I want you to see that world over what is happening with salt intake. So India is in the orange section. So if you see that sodium intake in India, where we are talking of 2 grams, here it is going up to 3.5 to 4.24 grams of sodium. So this is way beyond, this is, and on an average, this is the amount of sodium people eat in India. Oh, I'm so sorry. So this is the amount of sodium that people are consuming in India. So we really need to address this one thing, and look at some of the African regions. They are the ones which have the least consumption of sodium. So, you know, everywhere in the world, we are seeing that sodium consumption is not being addressed to that extent. So look at all the hidden sources of sodium. You know, we use very freely with our meals. There is a lot of papad going in, pickles. There are a lot of condiments and sauces. Chinese meals, the monosodium glutamate or the Ajinomoto. Then there are a lot of sauces. Then processed food consumption, we know how it's going on increasing in India. People are looking at more convenience foods. So that's increasing it. Bakery items all have soda bicarb, or they've got baking soda. All these have sodium. Cold cuts of meats have a lot of sodium added to them through, you know, some of the condiments or the chemicals that are added. Dairy products are salted butters, cheese, then namkeens. We know how much namkeen, you know, people in India consume. All these are adding. So we may consider 1 teaspoon of added salt in our meals, but we are forgetting all these other sources of salt. So we can't, you know, forget about these. As it is, we are eating too much salt. So we need to start addressing this urgently. So how would you really think, or what all can you do? I've given a few tips on how you could reduce it. So consciously measure and monitor how much salt is being used. For a lot of my clients, I tell them that actually in the morning, you know, just take out 5 grams, which is 1 teaspoon. You have a measuring teaspoon. So if somebody is suffering from high blood pressure, hypertension, measure the salt and use only from that measured amount. We have renal patients who are doing that all the time. You know, they have to be very particular, so they are very conscious. And I think we can do it at least, you know, for the day. If you know X number of people are eating food in the house, we can actually make an estimate of how much salt we are adding to our food. Then herbs and spices can be used to flavor foods instead of salt as well. Then smart pairing. Try and do smart pairing. So somebody who's eating processed meats and then eating it with bread. As it is, I just told you that bread has a lot of sodium because of the baking powder, baking soda, or you know, any other salt may be added to the bread also. Then you're eating processed meat with it. Together, that one meal itself is giving you so much sodium. So a smart pairing system, think about it, read the labels and decide, you know, what you should pair at the same time. Then incorporating potassium and magnesium rich foods. These work in the way opposite to sodium. So that will balance it off. So if the sodium is a little higher, eat potassium rich foods, that will bring down the adverse impact of sodium. Get aware of the sources of sodium. It's more than just salt. And in developed countries, you know, we've seen that 70 to 80% of salt intake comes from processed foods. So India is not very far from, you know, consuming a lot of processed foods. So we need to be conscious of that. Read labels. And if we have accurate labeling, then that also will help. Okay. Then we talk of physical activity. Now, World Health Organization believes that more than 60% of the global population is not active sufficiently. And we all know what physical activity, what benefits it has on our weight. Insulin is a hormone which is an anabolic hormone. It increases fat deposition in the body. So, you know, when you have a good physical activity, weight is reduced, then insulin is at the right level, then blood lipids, blood glucose, blood clotting factors, inflammation, blood vessel inflammation, all this is reduced. And, you know, that's the best thing that can happen out to manage lifestyle diseases. So how much physical activity is recommended? So more than 150 minutes per week of moderate physical activity can reduce the risk of CHD, that is cardiovascular heart disease, by about 30%. So 150 minutes per week is, you divide that by 7. That's not much. So we can easily, achieve this. And for those who already have a heart condition, it will reduce their risk of dying prematurely from any heart-related conditions. So, you know, there was, if I give you an example, that if a middle-aged woman is doing less than 1 hour of exercise per week, it doubles her risk of dying from cardiovascular event compared to a physically active woman of the same age. Now, what activity works for you, you have to decide. One doesn't have to go to the gym and work out in the gym only. There are different ways. You can go for a walk, you can do yoga, you can do different kinds of activities. So there is a whole range to choose from. And even small increases of activity are associated with a significant reduction in cardiovascular risk. Smoking, we all know it is damaging. I'm not going to talk too much about it, but we all know it damages the blood vessels. It increases the fatty deposits in the vessels, and it increases the clotting, increases LDL, which is the bad cholesterol, and it reduces HDL, which is good cholesterol, and it increases blood pressure. So smoking increases the risk of death by undiagnosed heart disease by almost 300%. So it's definitely something that needs to be addressed. Okay, let's now come to diet. I've already focused on salt because when we were talking about blood pressure, salt has a direct impact on raising blood pressure. So I've discussed it with that. Now, other things that we must focus on as far as diet is concerned is cholesterol levels, body weight, blood sugar levels, and blood pressure. So what does a diet do? Diet can be both ways. Two ends of the sword, you know. It can either increase your risk of heart disease or it can reduce the risk. So depends upon the kind of diet, the quality of diet which can work for you or against you. So let's talk of fat first. Now we know that, you know, the fatty deposits or the plaque which builds up inside the arteries, it can start at a young age. We just discussed that, you know, now even the youth are now suffering from a lot of heart related problems. Doctor has said that you start, you know, doing your tests and your, assessments right from a young age, start from 20 years. So now we have a guideline that as soon as, you know, our children turn 20, we should start monitoring their levels, and more so because we know the kind of diets, we know the kind of lifestyles most of the youngsters have these days. So this is a wonderful tip, I think, that 20 is our starting point for monitoring. And because if we don't do that, then by middle aged it can get quite advanced, and especially cholesterol can be is a very high one of the major risk factors for cardiovascular disease. So, you know, there has been a lot of discussion about fat, what is good, what is bad. Fat has probably been the most debatable nutrient since, you know, years. It's, you know, most of our recommendations start from America. And over the years, we've seen it going from, you know, being considered fat, all fat is being considered as a devil, and only low fat being promoted, low fat, low cholesterol. So there was a time when, you know, even the Dietetic Association, the Heart Association of America had popularized that low fat diets are what everybody should be following. And it was a belief that low fat was equal to low calorie. Now that wasn't true. I mean, so what American food companies started doing, since it was low fat, they started reducing the fat content in the foods, in the packed items, and that fat was being replaced by sugar. So while it looked like low fat, no fat, zero fat, it was being replaced by sugar. And ultimately, there was no reduction in calories. It was only the fat that had gone away. So there were, you know, introduction of a lot of foods like granolas, pancakes, pasta sauces, snack foods, which had no fat. But it was the beginning of the obesity epidemic. So what happened? Why was that so? Because fat was being demonized, and that was not the correct way to deal with fat. Then it was realized, you know, that it's not only fat, it's the type of fat which one has to focus on. So the Mediterranean diet came into the limelight, and it was considered to be the most heart-friendly diet. So what was this Mediterranean diet? It had monounsaturated fat, it had PUFA, it was low in saturated fat, and it had a lot of emphasis on plant foods, beans, whole grains, vegetables, fruits. So these were all, these had a protective factor about them. Small amounts of yogurt was okay, cheese was okay. Non-veg would mean more of fatty fish, some amount of eggs, white, you know, meats from poultry.
I'm sorry, your voice is breaking, ma'am.
Oh, is it? Okay, let me just check my Okay. Is it okay? I mean, I am connected. My signal seems to be all right. Is it true for everybody? Is everybody...
Ma'am, you're not audible. Hello.
Am I better? I mean, is everybody facing that?
No, ma'am. Your voice is clear, ma'am.
It's clear. Maybe your signal at your end.
No, I'm hearing it well.
Okay. So maybe your signal at your end.
Okay.
Yeah. Lots of, in terms of non-veg, it would have to be fatty fish, moderate amounts of egg, poultry, and very little red meat. So red meat means saturated fat. So it was now clear, more and more evidence was now there in support of the correct kind of fat. The right or the type of fat was far more important. So finally, fat recommendations came up. And what was that? That total fat intake can go up to 30% of total calories. So we don't have to bring the fat down to 0 and 5 and 10, you know, like it was being popularized at one time. So up to 30% total calories from fat is fine. But be careful of saturated fat. It should not be more than 10%. Cholesterol should be limited to 300 milligrams per day. Cholesterol also went through a lot of recommendations. Egg was considered as one of the worst foods. Then it was realized that no, egg, there's nothing wrong with that cholesterol. The body is making some cholesterol itself. Some cholesterol is coming from food. So if we have up to 300 milligrams of cholesterol per day from food, it's fine. Then comes trans fat. That's the devil. I mean, we have to really stay clear of trans fat. You know, cakes, cookies, fast foods, all these have trans fats. And that's what is really a big risk factor for increasing LDL levels in the body. So let's see what we should do now. Use healthy fats. Replace the saturated fats. Include oils which come from seed oils. You know, you have all the oils that we get are either from the plant oils are either seed oils or they're nut oils. So use a lot of seed oils. They are very good. You have some nuts also, which you can use for, your source of oil. And use more of, seeds even to eat. You eat seeds and have fatty fish. Unsalted nuts are good sources of fat. So fat is not bad. It's the type of fat that we need to focus on. So here's a lovely, a slide that I found. So you have love it, limit it, and lose it. So the one that lose it, we are not supposed to eat too much of it because they can raise cholesterol levels. I know one of the products here is coconut oil, which is very controversial. But if you're talking of LDL levels, if somebody has got high LDL levels, I would not recommend coconut oil. It definitely has saturated fat in it. So we've got, what to limit and what to love. So those are the polyunsaturated and the monounsaturated fats, which will certainly work on the, it'll be good for the heart. Now let's come to carbohydrates. Very interesting study done on 47,000 Italian women. And it showed that a diet which was high in white bread and pasta could double the chance of heart disease. And to all the women here, this particular study unfortunately did not show the same kind of results in men. So very, very funny, but women seem to have a greater incidence out of eating white bread and pasta. So what is it basically? What is lacking? What is the problem with white bread and white pastas and all? It is the fiber. So any food which has a lot of fiber is highly protective for the heart. That's why we say, white sugar is totally lacking in fiber. It is, it is empty calories. So we should really stay away from white sugars. We need food which has a lot of fiber in it. Fiber rich food is very protective for us. So refined starches should be out. Added sugars should be out. Sugar sweetened beverages also should be out from our diet. Concentrate on whole grains, lots of cereal fiber, which is very protective. And we've got, data which shows that 2 servings a day of these foods can, either you add 2 servings, which can reduce the risk, or you reduce 2 servings and you increase the risk. Plus, these foods also have a lot of other micronutrients, which we are focusing a lot on these days, folic acid, B vitamins. All these are really big protectors for our heart diseases. Then we have viscous fiber. viscous fiber is really important. It's found in oats, beans, fruits, and these have a very big role in lowering cholesterol levels. Now, today we talk of gut microbiome. We have a lot of good bacteria in our gut. Fiber increases these good bacteria. So include fiber, improve the gut microbiome, and reduce the development of cardiovascular disease, which because a dysbiosis or a bad gut microbiome is related to inflammation. And inflammation is the root cause of a lot of lifestyle diseases today. Proteins, we should include, go by the RDA and include a lot of healthy proteins from fish, seafood, legumes, nuts, seeds. We have a lot of plant proteins also that we can eat. There are adequate options for vegans, vegetarians, non-vegetarians. There are lots of protein sources. So let's see what a healthy plate should look like. What a healthy plate should look like for us. If we take this plate, our thali, even our Indian thali, half that thali should be occupied by vegetables, so it could be vegetables, fruits, combination, whatever. So cooked, raw, everything, half of it should be that. 1/4 should be protein foods and 1/4 should be whole grains. If we follow this system, we won't go wrong. But if we change this proportion, like I often speak, I have a lot of patients who come to me who are from the rural areas. If they are farmers and they're doing a lot of hard work, a lot of physical activity, then I might tell them to increase the grains because they need more calories and they need a little more, energy dense foods because of the kind of hard physical work they are doing. But in the urban areas, I don't usually see anybody needing that kind of grains. So it depends upon whom we are talking to, but in the urban setting, this works very well for most people. Alcohol provides 7 calories per gram. It increases, your caloric intake, and so it causes obesity, change in blood pressure, and heart-related lot of adverse effects are seen. Sedentary behavior, very important to address this. A study showed that women, when they sit for longer than 40 hours a week in front of the television, they have a 94% increase in their risk of developing obesity and 70% increase in risk of developing diabetes. Both these are risk factors for CVD. So it increases adipose tissue, it increases triglycerides, insulin sensitivity decreases, and glucose intolerance also increases. So we really need to be less sedentary in our lives and keep moving. So, movement can be exercise related, it can be non-exercise related, general movement, in the day. So I would, doctor has already talked of cell, assessments and what one should do. If I could talk about something that you could do at your own level, measure your waist. Central obesity will give you a huge idea about what is happening with the fat level in your body. Check your weight frequently. Calculate your BMI. If you go beyond the normal level, you need to start working on your weight. BP, blood cholesterol, blood sugar, this should all come into your regular body checks, depending upon at what age you are and how frequently you need to do it. But this is the basic self-assessment any of us can do. We don't have to really go to anybody to get these done. Of course, the blood profile we have to do, but a lot of this we can do ourselves. So the best things that you can do to reduce your risk of heart disease: have a healthy diet and maintain a healthy weight. And that itself can reduce your risk to a large extent. So thank you for your patient hearing. And I think we'll keep the floor open for questions now.
Yes. Thank you so much, ma'am. It was a wonderful presentation and quite informative. So now I think we have got a lot of questions in the chat box. If you allow me, I can take them one by one.
Yes, sure.
So ma'am, the first question is, it is addressed to Dr. Pathak actually. What are the basic symptoms? What are the basic symptoms of a heart attack? And what are? One second also.
Dr. Mani, I just wanted to ask, in our regular lifestyle at home, what are the basic symptoms of heart attack? And what are the first aid steps to be taken at home?
Yes, first aid steps to be taken at home.
And how useful is keeping the oxygen supply at home, which is available online on Amazon these days?
Thanks for that question. The basic symptoms, sometimes being told the basic symptoms is not a good idea, because an anxious person will start developing those symptoms and, you know, suffer unduly and undeservedly for this. But since you've asked, I must tell you, the heart attack is presented with discomfort in the chest and the adjacent portions of the body. It could go to the arms, forearms, even to the wrists. It can go to the jaw and neck, associated with sweating. It could also be pain on the shoulder ridges and in the central back. So it is discomfort, actually. We generally call it as pain, but it is actually discomfort, which could be burning sensation, which could be pressure, which could be stretching, which could be splitting sensation. But it lasts. It lasts. If it lasts moments, then it is not because of the heart. If it lasts for maybe 1 minute or more, then it is a sign of discomfort because of the heart disease, because of the ischemic heart disease, because of the impending attack. Sometimes people simply lose consciousness just after starting having chest pain. That could be a very, very sinister sign and should be immediately attended to. Then mainly one, the discomfort after taking meals, discomfort which is new, discomfort which is brought about by lying down, improved on sitting down, in the chest and adjacent areas, could be because of an impending attack or developing heart disease. So having recognized these, the best first aid would be ask the patient to lie down if possible. And if you're sure that, because especially if there are risk factors for heart disease like diabetes, heavy smoking, obesity, age generally beyond 40, definitely above 60, hypertension, all these associates could point towards an attack because such a person is predisposed. So a tablet of aspirin, 325 milligram in weight, should be dissolved in water and given. And in case it is not soluble, then give it straight away, swallow it. That is the basic first aid. And second is get the patient to lie down and ask him to relax. In case he feels dizzy, it is a good idea to keep the legs raised up. Have a feel of his pulse. In case the pulse is too slow or too fast, this could be a problem associated with the heart attack. In case the pulse is all right, the volume of the pulse appears good, then there is little to worry. But second point of caution is to immediately summon an ambulance or summon a doctor. Loss of consciousness, then one should not lose a moment and start from the home, either in their own vehicle or in case ambulance is nearby, then so be it. About the question on the oxygen, there is no such recommendation that oxygen be kept at home, excepting for those people who have got lung diseases and who have got severe smoking problems, asthmatics. For heart diseases, no. It's impossible, because in a little bit of time, the oxygen is going to get diffused away and your tank is going to be empty. You are going to need it maybe 1 in 10,000 chances, because giving oxygen at home does not help at all unless you have a heart failure, which is chronic. It is not for the first time. You'd already know, your doctor would already advise you for that. So keeping an oxygen cylinder at home is of no value unless you are living in high altitudes.
Okay, thank you, doctor. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, doctor.
There's one more question. It is, do collaterals exist in the other parts of the body also, except heart? How much do they open up with how much exercise? I don't know.
See, I believe this question is being asked for the way of reducing peripheral vascular resistance. And that's actually a very good question. Collaterals can occur in any part of the body excepting the brain. There are two types of collaterals. Number one, the collaterals which are naturally present, like in brain, there are four arteries supplying the blood to the brain. And they are connected to each other. Like if you see the geography of Jaipur, old Jaipur, then every road in an area is connected to the other road. So there's a road called Chota Rasta, there's a road called Jori Bazar. Both of them are multiply connected to each other. So the brain is like that. Brain has got lot of already collateralized arteries. So suppose there is a block, there would be the blood coming from the other side. But the most of the arteries, which are the end arteries, means there is no end to it. There is no egress to it. After a given, say, capillaries and arterioles, there is no. But the major arteries are connected through a structure called circle of Willis. So that is in the brain, but it does not get collateral. So if one gets a stroke because of the occluded artery, because of a clot, then that remains like that unless you give some thrombolysis or open it up with balloon or stent. In the heart, there are potential collaterals. That means the collaterals in normally open arteries with no blocks are not visible, but they are recruited. They are potentially there. They are recruited once the block takes place, and they may develop as early as 1 hour after the block. But generally, it takes about 1 to 2 days before the collaterals develop. But when we do primary angioplasties just after attack, we very frequently see collaterals coming to the artery which is in question. Probably because there could have been a block earlier on, and there was a 90% block, and now it is totally blocked. So those collaterals open up and recruit faster. But yes, collaterals do come up. In the other parts of the body, especially in the skeletal muscles of the limbs, I think the question is aimed at that. And in the limbs, there are potential arteries again. If you exercise, those capillaries and those collaterals open up, and that furnishes more blood to the muscle that helps more washout of lactates and toxic oxygen free radicals which are created during exercise. And if it is a sustained exercise, if it's an athlete, then he'll develop a metabolism according to that. Collaterals open up, so the peripheral vascular resistance goes low. Those people who are hypertensive, also exercise is recommended, because in the muscles of the calves and thighs, the arteries develop collaterals, and they help to reduce the peripheral vascular resistance and thereby reducing the blood pressure. That's it.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Sir. Thank you very much.
Yeah, welcome.
And there's one question from Mr. Suraj Shetty. He wants to know that why do people who do not smoke or drink at all also get heart attacks? So either of you, whoever wants to answer this question.
Oh, Dr. Poonam is welcome to do that.
Okay. So we've talked about a lot of risk factors. Alcohol and smoking are not the only two risk factors. So a person who doesn't drink and doesn't smoke may have some other risk factors. The person may be obese. The person may have a very poor diet. LDL levels may still be high. So it really depends. I mean, those are not the only two risk factors.
Okay. One, I would want to just interrupt. Excuse me. Are you through, ma'am? Are you
through? Yes. Okay. Please continue.
I'm sorry I interjected without taking your permission.
No, that's okay, sir.
But see, it is as Dr. Poonam has said, it is not just the smoking and alcohol. There are many risk factors which are now coming up. One does not even know about them. In Indian population also, there are genetic, because the coronary artery disease is polygenic. It is not just this or that. There are many gene-based, there are many environment-based, there are many many inherent problems of metabolism which also causes this. What I would, because heart attacks are taken as only pain in the chest. No, sudden cardiac death can be a manifestation. So their stress is a very, very big factor. Then if you see the people who consume amphetamines, those people who can consume the psychologically the psychogenetic materials like drug abuse, they may develop sudden severe vasoconstriction and they may meet their end or may have a sudden death very quickly. Cocaine is one of them because it's known that it increases the demand of the heart muscle for oxygen, and it is known to cause severe constriction of the arteries of the heart, which is brought about suddenly and can lead to death. So, and stress is one of them because even the muscle of the heart may suffer, and we call it apical ballooning syndrome or Takotsubo cardiomyopathy, right? So you see there's a healthy person, and because of the stress, severe stress, he suddenly develops ballooning of the apical part of the left ventricle. Once the stress goes away, the patient is taken care of, he's better, the heart becomes normal. I mean, that's one of the recent things, but it is absolutely been surprising to find people whom we thought were gone over the cases and only 30% ejection fraction, and in 7 days it comes out to normal. So that is Takotsubo cardiomyopathy. That's another very one interesting entity is called voodoo deaths. Those African tribes used to have a tradition of turning their people out who were renegades or who were, you know, out of line. So they were turned out of their tribes and kind of tankhaiya, jisko bolte hain Punjabi mein, they were outcasts. And these people would go out in the forest and simply die. That was also stress related, but they are known in the African regions as voodoo death. So there are many, many reasons for the heart disease and for the sudden death. Sudden plaque ruptures are also known to happen. That 80% of them happen in the sleep. So risk factors are besides the point, but there are many, many other things which can lead to heart attacks.
So this was quite informative and very insightful. Thank you, doctor. Thank you, ma'am. There's one more question for you, Poona ma'am. There is Priyanka Jain who is asking 18-year-old girl's diet plan. I believe that diet plan or the thali that you presented was for every age.
That is in general trying to tell, give everybody the message that we have to increase our intake of fruits and vegetables. Most of the time what happens is we see extra cereal, you know, too much rice, too much of chapati. Maybe chapati is healthy because it's from a whole grain, but the point is how much do you need of that? Because you know, we forget about the fruits and vegetables. The vegetable, I see people eat a very small portion of vegetable, and vegetables are very protective. They've got micronutrients, which are high fiber is there, micronutrients are there, which are needed for a variety of conditions for us. Nowadays, in fact, you know, as dietitians, we are focusing more on micros rather than just macros. Macros have been discussed, you know, like protein, fat, carbohydrate have been discussed extensively. People understand a lot about those three, but people are not focusing adequately on the micros. So fruits and vegetables are highly protective for our bodies. And that is why that plate was trying to show you that include that much fruits and vegetables, and vegetables could be raw or cooked, both. Half your thali has to be from these fruits and vegetables.
Maybe I think she wants to know if adolescents have a different kind of a requirement, because maybe they need more of calories or maybe.
So, that will have to be individualized, because at every stage of life, the requirements will keep changing. So a child who is in the growing age will have very different requirements versus somebody who's in the 60s or somebody who's in the 40s. Obviously, we know that through the life cycle, the requirements of nutrients change. So yeah, that is something that we have to look at individually. We can't have a general, this is a general guideline, but then individual diets have to be looked into separately, differently.
Yes, yes, ma'am. So I believe her query is also resolved to quite an extent. Now, there is again one more question. It's a part of the similar question that was earlier asked. It was that, can we have alcohol and smoke, can we continue with alcohol and smoking with healthy diet? No, you cannot, I think. But
doctor, would you like to address that? Smoking? How can you? Because I don't think there's anything about smoking which anyone can support. And even alcohol, you may have. I get a lot of this, you know, question many times.
They want to continue with the healthy diet, but not leave smoking and drinking.
But that's not healthy lifestyle for sure.
Yes.
So maybe doctor has something to add to that, we would love to hear him.
Well, see, should I tell you one incentive of smoking?
Oh, God.
That may not be a good idea. That will pick up very soon. But smoking has done good to nobody, excepting a very rare, but I would not mention that. It is not for us. So, smoking and tobacco in any form causes very early endothelial dysfunction. Endothelium means the inner lining of the arteries. So, once you damage them, the common properties of the arteries are gone. So, you will not vasodilate when you need them. You will not vasoconstrict when you need them. They become like plastic pipes. So, they don't become active circulatory lines. They become kind of pipes. They become non-resilient structures which are conduits only. So they lose their property. It's not good. Smoking and tobacco in any form, chewable, snuffable, whatever. Alcohol, I don't recommend it to anybody because I don't consume it myself. But red wines, they say red wines are good for health because they have lots of flavonoids and antioxidant properties.
Resveratrol is there, yeah.
Yes. So there has to be even a cap to that. You just can't drink like fish. You have to take it in a stipulated amount. And 80 proof whiskey up to 60 cc in 24 hours could be medically permissible to normal people. But it is not a prescription. I mean, you can't tell your wife that, see, that white-haired fellow was telling 60 cc in 24 hours is no problem. And since I'm overweight, 90 is no problem. You know how we can stretch ourselves. So alcohol is socially not good. But for recreational purposes, if one has to take, then it has to be gentleman's drink. The 80 proof whiskey, no more than 60 cc. No more than a beer in 24 hours. Should not be consecutive days. And it should not be a part of your curriculum. It should be something to enjoy maybe once in 2 weeks, 4 weeks. And that's it. That's individual perspective.
Thank you.
Doctor, can I ask a question here based on smoking that you just told us? So somebody who is an ex-smoker, somebody who's given up smoking, will there be a change in their endothelium? Will there be some recovery or whatever damage has been done is permanent?
See, a chronic heavy smoker is one who smokes at least one pack, means 10 cigarettes for 10 years or more, right?
Right.
So what the data says is that in Framingham, it says that in case you stop smoking today, then your cardiovascular risk starts going down after 2 years.
Okay.
Right. So the endothelial function is likely to be recovered unless you have already developed plaques which are non-resoluble. Once an artery develops a block, it does not go away. There, peripheral arteries, there is data to say that very strong control of cholesterol levels and abstinence from smoking or tobacco can reduce the plaque burden by 17% in 17% cases. But in coronaries, that does not happen like that. It is only that those plaques get stabilized. Okay. So the chances of an acute attack go less, but they are not normalized. So, but for the malignancy, the risk does not exponentially reduce. That's what I know. But for the coronary artery disease, after 2 years, your risk starts going down, but it will never become normal.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you're welcome.
Thank you, Doctor. There's again one more question, Doctor, it is for you. What is cardiac arrest? It has become very common among us these days.
Cardiac arrest is it has got a very heavy definition according to the American Heart Association, but it is cessation of the activity of the heart, leading to suffering of the organs, and it is actually sudden cardiac death. Sudden cardiac death is the type of death which is had when a person gets he's dead within 1 hour of developing symptoms. In a person who is not known to have heart disease, or has known to have heart disease but stable heart disease, in the last 24 hours he has been maybe stable or unstable, but in the last 1 hour he develops severe symptoms and dies. So cardiac arrest is, you can say, the final event. But there is some entity called aborted sudden death or aborted cardiac arrest, where either the patient is in the hospital or has got a very well-informed attendant or bystander who can defibrillate him. In Western countries, defibrillators are available on the in the, say, malls or stations or anywhere. So this can be. And the causes of, he has asked the causes, right?
Yeah.
Okay. The causes of heart arrest, cardiac arrest, the foremost cause is sudden block of the artery or sudden heart attack. So 80% of the heart attacks take place because of the blocks which are less than 50%. So we call them subcritical disease. They are because the cholesterol in them is very unstable. The cap of the plaque is unstable. So they suddenly destabilize, the plaque ruptures, the blood clot develops there, the heart rate, the heart muscle suffers dearly, and suddenly the patient dies because of arrhythmia. Another cause can be because of arrhythmogenic disorder, like cardiomyopathies, like weak heart muscle, like many we call channelopathies, where the heart rate suddenly develops absolutely haywire. It may go to 200, 300, 350, 400, so that the supply to the brain suffers and the patient falls down and injures himself or dies because of the sustained lack of blood supply to the heart muscle and the brain. So the causes of I've said ischemic heart disease, one of them, arrhythmias is another of them. The third is very severe pumping dysfunction of the heart, which is called advanced heart failure. So these are the mainly the causes of cardiac arrest.
Okay, thank you, doctor. And yes. One more question is there for you. What do I do? I think you are getting late and we are running short of time, but there are just two more questions. Okay. What are the causes of, what can be the causes of abnormal heartbeat? And can one take any precautions in this condition?
Abnormal heartbeats can be of two types. One is a very fast heartbeat, which is called tachycardia. And the other is called slow heartbeat, is called bradycardia. So it is, these are Latin terms. So we are taught from the first MBBS, so we don't know any Latin, but these words we know. So bradycardia is one where the heart rate goes below 60. The issue is whether the patient has got any symptoms. Sometimes your heart rate might even be 40 and you are not having symptoms, so we're not worried. We'd not advise you anything. But in case you have symptoms, the primary cause has to be treated, whether it is because of the drugs, because beta blockers can cause that. There are other drugs which can cause that. There are certain types of toxicities which can also cause reduction of heart rate. Page, some heart muscle disorders. You may have slowing of heart rate, which ultimately might need pacemaker implantation, right? Second is the tachycardia or fast heart rate. Tachycardia is nothing but the heart rate more than 100 per minute. And if it is coming out from the sinus node, that means normal beat, then we have to look into the reasons why it is taking place. But there are many types of tachycardias, and treatments for all of them are different. Some of them require implantable cardioverter defibrillator, a specific type of device which watches over the heart rate. And when the heart rate goes dangerously above a critical level, it monitors it, it overdrives it, and sometimes it delivers a shock and saves the patient. Other type of tachycardias could be atrial fibrillation, which is very common, which is abnormal, irregular, rapid heart rate. It has got many reasons. Basically, the reason has to be treated first, and the the heart rate has to be controlled by giving medicines or various other manipulations. That's the idea.
Okay. Thank you, doctor. Thank you. I have one question for Poonam ma'am. Ma'am, there is a lot of dieting and weight loss and, you know, all these things are so common these days. So is fast weight loss risky? And what should be the ideal speed of weight loss like?
Yes, definitely. We never encourage very rapid weight loss. And if you are actually following a balanced diet, a healthy balanced diet, then the weight loss will not be very rapid. It's only when people follow fad diets, which lead to very quick weight loss. And a fad diet will always compromise on some nutrition in the plan. So
it's called keto diet, right?
Keto is one of the fad diets. We have a whole range of, I mean, you have a lot of fad diets which have been followed over the years. And a fad, the minute we use the word fad diet, means it will promise, very quick weight loss. But along with that, we know that there will be some compromise somewhere in maybe some nutrition, you know, maybe very low calorie. So something will be there which will take it away from a balanced diet. So although it can give you very quick results, it will cause, you know, you have people who, there are a lot of clients who come to me and tell me that, you know, I've been losing a lot of hair and, you know, my skin is just looking so dull and it's the, you know, glow is completely gone. So why do you lose hair? Obviously, there's something that has suddenly gone missing from the diet that you start losing hair. So these are just very simple, you know, incidences, but a lot of problems can happen because of an imbalanced diet. So I would always recommend to every single client who comes to me to have a balanced diet that will give you, you know, slow weight loss, but it will be sustained weight loss. Something that you can, will last for a long time. You can follow that diet for the rest of your life. It's not going to make you struggle and it's not going to feel like it's a torture to, you know, follow that diet. But if you do fad diets, you feel almost tortured and you can do it for a month. Maybe you can stretch to 2 months. But beyond that, it is not sustainable. And these people will lose weight fast and they will gain it back also very fast. So there
once you lose fast, once you lose fast and then come on a healthy diet, then also you tend to put on weight.
Actually, it depends upon healthy diet. Again, what you're doing, you have to count calories. You have to, see the balance of, the nutrients. So I would rather focus on seeing what nutrients were compromised earlier. I would rather include all that, focus on that, get some tests done where vitamin D is always included, like doctor emphasized on vitamin D. In fact, every client who comes to me nowadays, I mean, since the last couple of years, not today, I insist on a vitamin D test first if they have not done it in the last 6-8 months. So vitamin D is something that most people don't even pay attention to. So we see that most of them come back with deficiency of vitamin D. So, and in a fad diet, you're bound to see some deficiencies like that. So definitely, you know, we have to look at a lot of nutrients. And I think that's where the role of a dietitian comes in. And where we are paying attention to a lot of micronutrients, the balance of nutrients, so that, you know, their health is not compromised in any way.
Okay, thank you. Anything else that you also want to discuss among yourself, sir, ma'am? Want to have any last few words before we end?
Well, I would just like to add that I learned a lot about diets today. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. And I learned a lot about the medical part of heart also. Thank you so much too.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ma'am, there's one last question that you talked about increasing calcium and magnesium in foods to combat the sodium intake or yes, the ill effects yes. of salt. So yes. if you could just, tell a few foods rich in calcium and magnesium.
So calcium would be a lot of your sources, dairy has a lot of calcium. So whether it's dairy, then soya beans have a lot of calcium. If you want to look at cereals and millets, ragi is one of the richest sources of calcium. So eat more ragi, include ragi in foods. Then, you know, even your til seeds, sesame, has a tremendous amount of calcium. Include sesame, you can sprinkle it on salads, you can eat it as a mouth freshener after your meals. Have a lot of green leafy vegetables, tremendous source of calcium. So we have a lot of foods which give us calcium. Then we talk of potassium. Most fruits and vegetables will give us potassium. The richest ones would be, coconut water. Then you have banana, you have oranges. But you will find potassium. It's a really widespread nutrient found in fruits and vegetables. So again, what I was telling you about including more fruits and vegetables, this will automatically take care of that also. So right. There are micronutrients. It is, you know, we have only touched upon a few of them. There are so many micronutrients that the body requires. We call them micro, means they are required in very tiny quantities. But if you don't provide that tiny quantity, it can create havoc in the body.
Yes, yes. Very true, very true. I think Doc Sab is also getting late. Doc Sab, yes. Are you getting late? There is one last question if you can.
All right. All right.
It is from Mr. Suresh Bhavan, and he's saying, what is your take on pulmonary embolism vis-a-vis heart attack?
Sir, good afternoon. Yeah, that's a question which would be really interesting. Sir, one of the reasons of sudden cardiac death is pulmonary embolism. Right. So, pulmonary embolism is an entity wherein the arteries of the lungs get suddenly clogged down by a clot which has most likely traveled from the lower extremities. And this leads to sudden reduction of cardiac output because the lower extremities drain bad blood towards the lungs for purification. And this goes through the inferior vena cava, going to the right side of the heart and thence into the pulmonary artery, so arteries of the lungs. These are for purification purposes. Once it gets cleaned, it comes, the oxygenated blood comes to the left side, to the left atrium, left ventricle, and thence to the systemic circulation. So that's a general layout. So this clot, if sufficiently large, will travel and will go unobstructive till the division of the pulmonary arteries. The pulmonary artery divides into two equal branches. So in case it goes and lodges there, it is called saddle thrombus. So saddle is like saddle of a horse. So one leg is one side, the other leg is the other side. That's what is happening with the clot. So on the bifurcation side, it is sitting tight on that like a rider. One leg on one artery, the other leg on the other artery. So flow to the lungs is gone. So what is happening? Two things. Number one is there is a lack of forward blood flow, reducing cardiac output. Number two, the right side of the heart suddenly fails because it is not powerful enough to keep pumping blood in the face of severe obstruction or kind of a lockdown. So the patient develops low cardiac output. The left heart does not receive pure blood. The patient does not receive pure blood to the brain, and that's it. But it can be many presentations. It could be massive. It could massive means your heart, the pulse, the heart, BP of the patient drops down or he gets an arrest. Submassive means where the BP is maintained somehow with increased heart rate compensating it. And there is a kind of compensatory tachycardia, but the heart on the right side dilates. Then there is moderate pulmonary embolism and there's small pulmonary embolism. So moderate and small pulmonary embolisms are not so dangerous unless they are in the face of an old pulmonary thromboembolism. So patient has already suffered once before sometimes, the arteries are already partly clogged and now you have another small clot coming up. So it behaves like a big clot. And then the patient might have cardiac arrest or die or have fall of BP. And heart attack, it is generally because of the blockade of the arteries which supply the heart muscle. So here is the contrast. Here, one is the arteries which supply the lungs, not supply the lungs, but take impure blood to the lungs for purification. And the other side is the arteries which supply blood and nutrition to the heart muscle, so it can keep on going like a pump. That's what the purpose of the heart is. So both of them are equally dangerous, and it was not recognized few years back when I went to PGI, Chandigarh, for my training. That time in Rajasthan, it was taken that it is an entity which takes place only in temperate zones. So but cold atmospheres only there, we don't get it. And then we were taught there that this is as common as the cold places. You be wary of it. So of the reasons of cardiac arrest, one of them is pulmonary embolism. You always have to keep in your mind.
Yes. Thank you, doctor. Thank you so much.
Yeah, we are welcome. And very educative. Very educative about the diet, Dr. Poonam. Thank you. And
thank you, sir. Thank you.
And my regards to the last...
thank you, yeah. Doctor. Thank you, ma'am Poonam. It was a pleasure having you both for the webinar. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye. Good luck.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye, sir. Bye, ma'am.
Bye. Thank you.